great pleasure to get to visit with John G. Pennington from George Kell Motor Company right here in Newport, and a new venue that we have. And it's kind of something that we did several months ago, John. Remember when, where we get out and we talk to a few of the people that have been instrumental in the great name of Newport and Jackson County. We're going to be doing Sonny Burgess this time, and Bud and Sonny will be doing the interview. And we want to thank George Kell Motor Company for being the lead sponsor on this. And we're excited about getting going again. Number one, Bud's excited about getting back to work. And anytime you visit with Sonny Burgess, you got a pretty good interview on your hands.
Boy, I tell you, that's an amazing guy. And we take him for granted because he lives on Wilkeson Drive. We see him around. We don't think much about it. But you go to Europe, you go to London, you go to Spain and some of these other places, that guy is a legend over there. We kind of take it for granted because we see him all the time. We don't think as highly of
him. Absolutely.
But
he's
not
just Sonny.
Yeah, he's just Sonny Burgess, you know. And I worked for him, you know, when I had Samson Sports and Sam Adams. And it's just a guy that I know, but he's legendary, and he's one of the founders of rockabilly music and rock and roll. And you think of Elvis and Carl Perkins and all those guys. He's one of those guys.
He is one of the guys.
Right in the middle of it.
Yeah,
right
one of the first.
Sun, right over at Sun Studios in Memphis. And we just kind of think, well, that's Sonny, you know. But he's an amazing guy, and I've got some of his music that I've got on a little iPod thing, you know.
Right.
When I'm mowing my yard, if you ever come by my yard when I'm out mowing, and I stop and hit a few licks on the handle of it, don't think anything about it. I'm just rocking along with Sonny.
Yes, sir.
Me and Sonny got it going.
Yes, sir.
But anyway, it's a pleasure to be the lead sponsor, and George Kell Motors is pleased to be a sponsor of something that we think is important, David, because there is a lot of history and a lot of things that go on in Newport. A lot of people take for granted, like Sonny. And I told you in my travels in another life, all those countries and states I used to go to, I'd be on a plane and somebody'd say, "Are you from Texas?" "No, I'm Arkansas." "Well, we're in Arkansas." "Do you know, somebody knows somebody from Newport, Arkansas?" It's amazing. My daughter-in-law talked about it this last weekend. She was in California. She works for Simmons Food, and she's a food scientist and does stuff for Kentucky Fried Chicken, Taco Bell, and pizza, and develops all their menus and all that kind of stuff. And she was out. She said, "You can't believe this, John. I was out in California and was sitting visiting with some people in a restaurant, and the thing came about where are you from?" She said, "I'm from Arkansas. I live in Little Rock, but my husband's from Newport. Newport, do you know?" And she started naming people.
Absolutely.
It's unbelievable.
Yes, sir.
And I'm sure every town has that, but not, I don't think, to the extent that Newport has. But it's a great place. You and I say it every time we do a show. It's a great place to live. It's a great place to come back to, and I'm never leaving again.
And, yeah, me either.
But let me visit just a little bit, if we can, here on this car business.
Absolutely.
Want to thank everybody for a fabulous 2013.
Right.
And want to continue to ask people to come see us, come visit with us, come take a look at what we've got with the Chevrolet Buick GMC lines, these new 14 trucks. I told you this on the last show we did. I hate my 13. Boy, I couldn't wait to get it, and that's got 8,000 miles. I hate it. These new ones are so much better built. They're quieter, they're stronger, they're bigger on the inside. Just come take a look at one of these Chevrolet Silverados or one of these GMC Sierra pickup trucks. They're just phenomenal.
They are.
They are. And I'm going to get one.
Yes, sir.
One of these days. But come out, and listen, I'll tell you something else. We have been so busy in the shop. So many people have been coming out that we haven't waited on. And there's so many people that are coming out saying, "Well, we never really came out here before, but we're glad we did. You treated us nice. You gave us something to drive when our car was in the shop. I came out here to buy tires, and you gave me the best price on tires. And while I was here, I got some other stuff done, and we're going to start using George Kell as our regular service dealership.
Right.
We like the way you do business, and we like the way you price your stuff." I had a customer the other day. They were going to charge him $600 to do warranty work on his car down in Little Rock. $600 to do warranty work. He just happened to be down there. He was having a problem, and he limped on in here and said, "What's it going to cost?" And we said, "It's not going to cost you anything." He said, "They're going to charge me $600 to do this in Little Rock." He said, "I'm glad I limped in." So, you know.
Big city.
Give us a shot. Give us a shot at all your business. Everything that you can think of, from your tune-ups, your tires. And certainly we want to sell you a new used or program vehicle. We think we're the best in the business. And if you'll give us a shot, I think you'll figure out we are.
Well, there's no doubt you guys do a great job of taking care of your customers. You know, pricing stuff up front, whether it's buying an automobile or buying some tires or getting service work done, whether it's a brake job or, you know, major work in the shop. You guys, if you get customers in and you don't get them in for one time or two times. You get them in, and most of your customers, honestly, John, are there for life.
Yeah, yeah.
They're there for life.
We've got people that drive from Batesville, that drive from Jonesboro, that drive from different places to come up here and do service work. They call, and, of course, Russell and Ronnie and Scott and all those guys in the back, they make an appointment. They take care of them. They shoot square with them. And, you know, it's not an unheard of thing for somebody to take one of our vehicles. I've got one of my customers who had to have some major work done on his Tahoe, and he took our vehicle and went to Oklahoma City.
Right.
But that's what he had. That's where he was going on business.
That's what he had to do.
He took one of our loaners, and that's what we've got them for, is to loan them to people when they need them. Just give us a shot at what we do, and I think, you know, if you'll do that, you won't ever need to go anywhere else. We'll take care of it.
Well, we again thank George Kell Motor Company for being the lead sponsor on the Remember When program, and we've got some great guests lined up. The first one is Mr. Sonny Burgess, and we're going to get right to it with Bud Black and Sonny Burgess, brought to you by George Kell Motor Company and John G. Pennington. Thank you.
Always a pleasure, David.
Yes, sir. Welcome, everybody, to Remember When, as we renew our series here on Cable 15 TV. I am Bud Black, along with a very, very special guest, Newport native, friend of many, pioneer in the rock and roll business, and at 84 years old, still knocking them out, Mr. Albert Sonny Burgess, who I'm proud to say has been a friend of mine since I was old enough, Sonny, and tall enough to have a friend. And
I remember you and David and Kenny back when your dad first got here to Newport.
You betcha. In 1956, Buddy Black opened a tire store down on 3rd Street. And then, of course, Adams Brothers filling station. And I spent a lot of time at the tire store. And that's when I first met Sonny Burgess. And I got to tell you, I've told you all along how much you meant to me, but you were my idol. You know, it wasn't Elvis. It wasn't Sonny Burgess, and I always wanted to be around Sonny Burgess. And I can remember later on going down there, and some of you guys just be sitting around picking all the time.
Yeah, we're trying to sell a little music there at the Adams Brothers.
Yes, yeah, just picking, you know, and it was absolutely amazing to me, and that was my first recollection. But I want you to tell us about when and where you were born.
I was born out here in Anderson community. Okay, nobody... Nobody knows where Anderson is.
Okay.
You know where Hickory Grove is?
Certainly.
Okay, the highway, when you hit the Hickory Grove, take the highway and runs up through Elgin. I forget what the name of the highway is.
Okay.
Blacktop now, but used to be gravel. Anyway, it goes all the way up. On the left-hand side is Anderson, where Bud Williams, okay. Reuben Harper had the farms and everybody. That's where we all live. Grandpa had a farm up in there, too. C.C. Burgess.
No, I know that property very, very well.
Okay, that was Anderson community.
Back over there and back toward Black River, I've done some fishing, you know, up there. I used to crappie fish up there, as a matter of fact.
Black River, Grandpa owned a lot of land over there.
Mm-hmm, okay. And so you were on the farm, basically.
Huh? Yeah, I was bred and born on the farm. Picked cotton, chopped cotton.
That's fun, wasn't it?
No, it wasn't.
You'd rather pick guitar than pick cotton?
No. Oh, man, yeah, that's how I got into music.
How in the world, what year were you born? You're 84, it doesn't matter, they can do the math, you know.
1931.
31.
I'm sorry, 1929.
29. So you were old enough, by the time you were 6-7 years old, to be right in the middle of the Depression.
Right.
I remember that.
We didn't know anything about a Depression. It was just the way you lived, you know.
Sure.
In other words, poor people were just like everybody else seemed to me like.
We were depressed all the time.
Yeah, you just, you didn't know you weren't. You know, nowadays you got television and all these lawyers and everybody else telling you what a sad shape you're in.
Mm-hmm.
Well, back then you didn't have all this. So you may do with what you had.
That's why I say, you know, the world, the social media and everything else, and, you know, and the world can change with one little old news announcement. There's something happened, you know, 10,000 miles away that years ago never would have affected us. Yeah. But now they blow it out of proportion to where it's the end of the world, you know.
Yeah, it's just, the TV especially now, it's like every day something happens and they just blow it up.
Ratings. Yeah. Looking for ratings.
You know? Looking for ratings.
How in the world did you want to be a musician? When did you start picking a guitar and how did you learn?
I want to be a baseball player.
I know that. And you and you're a big baseball fan, and we're going to talk about that. As a matter of fact, Sonny was assistant Legion coach several years here in Newport.
Yeah, with Dwight Williams and
Dee Stewart. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. But you wanted to be a baseball player.
Yeah.
How'd you pick up a guitar instead of a glove?
Well, I had two uncles. Paul Davis lived out there in the sand with us. Mm-hmm. They married Burgess girls.
Okay.
Paul did. And Theodore Churcher, who Larry Churcher's still here in town. And he married Joaquin. But they were both musicians. So they got to taking me around with them to hear different musicians play. And on the Sundays, we'd go to somebody's house that played music. Then sometimes, about once a month on Saturday night, we'd go to somebody's house. They'd have a big country dance. And I got playing rhythm for them. That's how I got started.
How'd you learn? You just from watching them, or did they teach you?
Yeah, that watching them play. Huh? Theodore played guitar and harmonica, and Paul played the fiddle.
Did you ever sit around and listen to WSM, the Grand Ole Opry?
Oh, man, that's all that you get. WDIA out of Memphis.
Memphis, yeah.
The black station.
Yes, uh-huh. Soul
station.
And then
WSM, and then the one in, what the heck was it, out at Gallatin out there. What was the name of that station?
WLAC, maybe? Nashville?
No, was it WLAC? They sounded black. And in 1956, when 57, when Buckets Got a Hold of It came out, we went to Nashville. We got on the Ralph Emery show, along with Marty Robbins, and he played it, and we talked and sat around there a couple of hours. And then we went out to Gallatin, where you had John R. Roberts, I believe.
Yeah, now John R. was on WLAC many years. AM 15 something.
Yeah.
Because I used to listen to that when I was a teenager.
Yeah, they were powerful. But to me, they sounded black.
Yeah.
And we get out there and they're white guys.
White guys. Well, it was amazing to me at how many white guys worked at DIA in Memphis, you know. And it was the black station, the recognized black station. A great, great music station.
Yeah, that was what we got to hear.
You see, I grew up loving rockabilly and soul music, and what happened is early stages, middle stages of country was just beginning to change a little bit, and then you infuse the soul music into that, and we got the thing they call rockabilly. It had that beat, it had that drive that soul music has, yet it had the country twang to it.
Yeah, well, that came mostly out from West.
Art form of its own.
Yeah, Western swing, that came out of the West. That Bob Wills, I guess, is one of, I don't think he created it, but he made the most out of it. Then you had a couple of bands on the West Coast that was big in it. Yeah. But the rockabilly came along when they added drums to country.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what a change.
Yeah, that time, see, on the Grand Ole Opry, they wouldn't, when Elvis first appeared, they wouldn't let him use drummer.
Mm-hmm.
Then the second time he was there, he did, but they didn't accept him. He was a little too...
Yeah, I started to say, it was not a big, big success.
And, yeah.
You know? And it's a shame he never made anything out of himself, you know?
It's a shame. Hey, we worked for Cash. I bought one of those posters at us with Cash when we was traveling with Cash in the 50s. And Cash was knocking them out back then, too, like Elvis was.
Hello, I'm Johnny Cash.
But, that was the way it started.
Yeah.
And but the funny part of it was, they said they were part of the Grand Ole Opry about 58 or 59, somewhere along in there. And Luther and Marshall, Johnny, said, man, we don't want to go to play on the Grand Ole Opry. I said, why, man? That, you know, that's what was traveling.
It's big time.
Big name. He said, Well, what they do is they pay Johnny $25 on a Saturday night. They pay me and Lewis said, pay me and Marshall 12 and a half apiece. Now, can you imagine? Here's a guy selling out auditoriums and making thousands of dollars, and they want him to come in there
for
to use the Grand
bucks.
Ole Opry name. They had a racket going. I don't know whether they still have or not, but they had a racket going.
Yeah, they're still on the air, you know. Yeah. That's absolutely amazing. But anyway, you got to learn how to pick a guitar, and I guess
still trying.
Yeah, still trying. You're still trying to work at it.
Still trying.
and all through what, junior high, senior high?
No, in senior high, I had a boy named Doodle Phillips. Had a Martin. I had a Martin J1-200,
oh,
I believe it was.
Oh, valuable. Oh, the old Martin guitars
today. I wonder
whatever
happened to Doodle. Don't even...
You know, I watch Antiques Roadshow, you know, and my gosh, they'll have Martins on there, and they go for just thousands of dollars.
Oh, this thing had a great sound. He let me play it. And then I wound up getting me a Sears and Roebuck.
You got to start somewhere.
Yeah. Well, they made a pretty good guitar. They made a K guitar back then.
Yeah.
And it was a pretty good guitar for the money.
So were you just picking on your own, or did you have any groups back then before in high school, or did you
no,
think
not at, in high school?
Did you think at that point that, you know, I'd like to do this maybe one day and try to record, make a living?
I don't think we ever thought about recording, but we started. Finally, we put us a little band together, me and Gerald Jackson from Mountain of Sand. John Ray Hubbard from the air base, mm-hmm. He had a bass, and Bobby Stoner lived out in the sand mm-hmm. at that time. And that was, we called ourselves the Drifting Cowboys, after Hank
Oh,
Lee.
This is ahead of the Ramblers even. This
oh,
is before
yeah.
the Ramblers, all right.
But it turned into the Rocky Road Ramblers.
Right.
We had two other, I don't know where we got Rocky Road. Anyway, we got to following Bigham Langley and the Grizzle Brothers around. They'd show these movies around the community, like Amigan, all these different little communities had a schoolhouse. You remember back then, like Anderson had a schoolhouse, Hickory Grove had a schoolhouse. They'd come in and show a movie, and for 10 cents or a nickel, you could see the movie. And he'd let us get up and play. Didn't make nothing, we didn't make nothing, but he let us get up and play. See, and that's, so we went two or three names, and then we fooled around, we got on KNBY. That was 5 days a week, 30 minutes a day. That's where we come from Freddie Hart.
Mm-hmm. Easy loving.
Yeah. Fred Wainard was his name. He's living with the Pattersons there on Malcolm. He used to be in the bait business and all, plumbing and bait business. And he didn't even have a guitar. But we got acquainted with him. We had A.L. Wilson. He played A.L. A.L. played steel. A.L. worked out there at the air base where your daddy come in.
Mm-hmm.
That's how come
right.
A.L. here was the air base when they had the Trimfoot Shoe Factory and Everything was booming back then. And
right at the end of the war, you know,
yeah.
And then post-war, you know, most all of the big factories that opened in Newport, you know, opened in 46, 47, you know, and there was just a tremendous need, you know, and so it was a booming community,
it just looked like it would never end. You come to Newport, because everybody had to come to town on Saturday, most everybody on Saturdays, because most everybody come in was farmers. But on Saturdays, you couldn't get down Front Street. There wasn't no lie about that. You had three theaters.
Mm-hmm.
You had three drug stores. You had three men's stores. We had
about
everything.
15 women's shops.
Yeah.
it was.
And department store. You remember having
yes.
the leader? Me
yes.
and Claude Burris were talking about that today. He's to... Remember the leader department store was Alfred Bierhoff.
Yes, Al Bierhoff. His slogan was, and he used to do it on the radio, it's cheaper at the leader.
Anyway, they'd bring in this guy for Tough Nut. He was 7 foot something tall. He was taller than the awnings they had out over the sidewalk. And they'd give away them Tough Nut pocket knives.
Yeah, that's a big attraction.
He still had one of them.
I remember it was either Star or PK's that had a guy come in, and he was called Izzy Human. And he would freeze, and you could laugh, and you could get in his face and everything, and you won a dollar if you could make him move. You know,
I never got to see him.
Is he human? I'll never. The most amazing thing I ever saw in my life. Hey, we got so much to talk about, and we're going to take a short time out. And by the way, during some of our timeouts, we're playing some Sonny Burgess songs, and you've already probably, I think, heard part of Redheaded Woman. I want to talk specifically about that, and we want a boogie when we get back. We're visiting with the legendary, the one, the only, rock and roll, rockabilly Hall of Famer, Sonny Burgess. We'll be right back.
I will have standing on a corner with my bucket in my hand. I'm just waiting for one.
The legendary Sonny Burgess on Remember When, an exclusive service of Cable 15 TV, and a program available to you at cable15tv.com also, so people all around the world can see us.
Oh, that's good.
On the web, and I know there will be people all around the country find out that Sonny Burgess is on here. They'll want to hop on the internet and see the show, and we appreciate Sonny doing this. Gentlemen, as I said, I've known all my life, always been a friend to me and my family. And I have at home a bunch of original Sun records, and I have a whole bunch of them by Sonny Burgess. And I'm holding on to them because you know what? They're worth a little something today.
That's right. I'm going to tell you, that there's certain ones, especially if they're in mint condition. Of course, you probably played them.
Yeah, mine are in what I call very good condition, but not mint. I bought them to play them.
Mint.
And you know what my favorite is of all time. I've told you this before, my bucket's got a hole in it. Well, tell the story you tell about you and Ricky Nelson, about how many copies were sold. I love this.
Oh, the joke I told, I don't know actually what we did sell. Sam never did tell us what we sold. We recorded it in 56. They released it in 57. And then in 57, Ricky Nelson had got famous singing, and he covered us. He loved Sun Records. Elvis was his hero.
Sure, he did a lot of Sun covers.
So he loved, of course, the Burnett Brothers was out there, and they were writing songs for him. But anyway, he covered it. Then what, 96, Plant and Page, Led Zeppelin.
Yes.
Record. And the funny part about them, after I met them, got to talk to them and everything, they said, they recorded it just like we did. And they said, all them, that background singer sounded like a church choir. That background singer was Johnny Ray, Joe Louis and Jack Nance, so they could sing harmony if you...
Church choir, huh?
Yeah, oh, he thought it was fantastic.
Anyway, I got off track, but my bucket's got a hole in it. What Sonny's talking about is Robert Plant and Jimmy Page of Led Zeppelin, the legendary rockers Led Zeppelin, recorded that song, and he said recorded his version of it, not Ricky Nelson's. And they talked about it on the PBS special, how much they liked the song. And he didn't say by Ricky Nelson, he said by Sonny Burgess.
Well, Ricky recorded faster than we did.
Mm-hmm.
And they changed, of course, Hank Williams had my bucket won't hold no beer. Well, of course, Ozzie and Harriet wouldn't let him say beer.
Yeah.
So they changed it to milk.
Yeah, but our version said no beer. Yeah, you know.
Well, that was Hank. We got it off of Hank Williams.
Right. Okay, we got the Ramblers. You're out of high school. You're out of the Army. 2 year stint in the Army, 51 through 53.
Working at the box factory at the Air Base.
Okay, get back in 54 here, and who gets the idea to put a band together? Who put the Ramblers together? And
I guess I did. I was always trying to put different bands together and trying different things. I always like to try something different. So anyway, again, me and Gerald, John Array, and then we decided we'd pick up Kern. See, Kern had been
Kern
playing
Kennedy,
a little in and out with us, but we decided we'd try and play Bob King's and the Silver Moon. So we go up there, and we get up there to Bob King's, and we walk up, that's the 54, we walk up there, there's that little hill, and they had a screen door. By the time we reach up to get over that screen door, just blowed open. People rolled out of there fighting. Scared the heck out of us. So we go back home, and Bob's right in the middle of them, that blackjack. Whap, whap, whap. We run back home about two
nice or three family weeks. Atmosphere.
Now, about 2 or 3 weeks later, we finally got nerve enough to go back, and we got a job playing. At that time, we'd done picked up Gerald, he didn't want to play clubs. So me and John Ray had picked up Kern and a boy named Paul Whaley from out here at Grubbs, the Whaleys at Grubbs.
Mm-hmm.
And he'd come in from California, sung just like Hank Thompson. Little guy, good-looking little guy. Women just loved him. He was our singer. So we played along. About a year he stayed, and then he went back to California. That's when I had to try and learn how to sing. John Ray wouldn't sing. Kern didn't sing. So it wound up me trying to sing.
You had the Ramblers, and then you started playing a lot of gigs at the Silver Moon.
Well, we had to add a horn player now when we got the Silver Moon.
Okay.
Don wouldn't hire us unless we had a horn player.
Okay.
So go about Dave, I always kin to Carlin James now. That was Dave's last name. He left here, worked for REA. He was a horn player.
Okay, all right. And anyway, changed the name to the Moonlighters because of the Silver
Moon.
Because
of the Moon, yeah. Because of the Silver Moon. See, we were playing theirs.
You basically can become the house band, I guess, at the Moon.
So we became the Moonlighters. Then we went to Bob King, we became, which this picture became the King's Four.
Okay, right here. This picture, being right here in the middle, and I'll try to get my knee out of the way. Moonlighters.
The Moonlighters, yeah, was a good group. The best group I ever had, out of putting all the groups together.
Sonny's got a picture or two here.
Was the original Pacers.
The original Pacers here. Ben will
probably the greatest show group has ever lived.
All right, let's start. Yeah, I've seen that picture. That is fabulous.
That's the one we made over here at the high school in 1956. Joe Lewis was still in high school.
A member
of the N Club, and the N Club had wanted us to play for him for this little concert.
Mm-hmm.
And Redhead Woman had just come out. So we went over there, and that's Champ Hosler made that picture for us.
Okay. You know, I didn't know Big Joe very well. I knew Jack Nance very, very well.
Big Joe was one of the world's best. He'd know you no matter where you're at.
Right,
He was a great personality and was really a talented musician. I wasn't smart enough. I should have been. He could have been a star. He had the personality and everything else and the looks. He was good looking. Boy, women loved him.
Yeah.
If I
big guy.
Yeah.
Big guy.
6'5", I think.
Yeah.
He was playing football, see.
Mm-hmm.
But if I'd had any sense, I'd have really used him more singing because he had everything that a star needs.
Okay.
He had everything I didn't have. See, I wasn't that good looking.
Okay.
I didn't have the personality.
That's when, 56, you say?
1956.
Okay. Now, did the group disband, and then you go on the road with 20 for a while?
Well, I was 57 when we cut it down. We cut the band down because that goes into another long story.
Okay.
Jerry Grogene worked at the radio station, was our manager. Mm-hmm. Okay, Jerry is assistant manager of KNBY. So he's drawing $100, $100 and a quarter a week.
Yeah, big money.
But yeah, that was big money back then. But he's with us, so he's our manager. We didn't have any sense. We didn't know nothing.
Okay, y'all just rocking and rolling.
We're just having fun. That was the whole thing. Money didn't matter. Money never matters to musicians when they start.
You told me one time, a long time ago, said that, you know, it was. I said, why'd you want to be a rock and roller? And you said, and I'm telling, I have to doll this up, okay? He said, it's a good way to meet girls. I guess it was.
Yeah.
I guess if you were on stage and playing.
Yeah,
and
you're a hero when you're on
that's
the
right.
stage.
It's a good way to meet girls. Okay?
Yeah, you can be the sorriest son of a gun in the world, but when you're on that stage, everybody thinks you're a hero.
That's right. They you love know, you. They love you.
We're
sort of like this old media right here, you know. You know, they say, I tell people, this isn't CNN or NBC, and they say, yeah, but you know, I can sit at home and watch you. You're on that screen, you know.
Yeah.
We appreciate that. Thank you so much for watching, you know. But anyway, you whittled the band down a little bit, man.
Oh, well, hot business got bad. So Jerry, in 57, me and John Rand Kern went to Memphis at the Sterick Building, which that picture has got, the Sterick Building. That was Bob Neal agency.
Bob Neal, WMC TV and, yep. And AM radio. Okay.
Yeah,
is that the same picture?
He was booking. He and Bob, him, Sam Phillips set up this booking agency to book the Sun artist around. See, and they, mm-hmm. that's what he was doing. So anyway, we went over there. We said, we need to travel with somebody. So he said, well, I'll set you up with Elvis. Well, in the meantime, Elvis is leaving or gone. So that never happened.
Yeah, he headed to Hollywood.
Yeah, but so anyway, somebody tells Grogene about this and nothing ever happened. So I guess it's 56 and went over and I talked to Bob Neal about a year later. I was working for cash. And I said, what happened there? I said, we never heard from him. He said, well, said your manager, Jerry called me and crying, said you was trying to take them away from me. He said, I don't need them. Said, they're yours. But Jerry was not going to leave Newport, Arkansas, where he had a steady job.
Right.
The music business is current favorite saying, one day chicken, the next day feathers.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You
man's got to eat.
Yeah, it's tough. It's tough. So that was what really, so we had to cut the band down. So we cut out Russ and Joe because they weren't married. We figured that'd be a
single,
little easier.
Single guys make it a little, yeah. little better. Okay.
And make it a little easier than the married guys. So.
And so I know Joe immediately caught on with Conway, didn't he?
Yeah. Well, Conway had been in Canada as Harold Jenkins.
Yeah.
And Billy Riley was down the street from him in Hamilton, I believe, where they were at.
Don't get me started on Riley, the late Billy Riley, a great friend of mine, man. I can tell. You can tell more stories about Riley than I can, but I know most of the good ones.
J.M. them had their, they was up there with Riley's, and something, they got into it about money. They wanted more money, so they quit and come back home. Well, Riley hadn't got a band, so he come down the street, and he hires Twitty's band. He offered, they were getting $100 a week, which was big money back then.
Mm-hmm.
He offered them $125 a week, so they go with Riley. So Harold comes home, and Jack is playing drum for us, but Joe was not doing anything, so him and Joe got together, and they talked to Jack, so Twitty hires them. They go back to Canada, and Blackie Preston becomes a bass player with them, so they go back to Canada, and that's when we picked up Bobby Crawford, last part of 57.
Right. Okay. And they're in Canada when Conway or Harold Jenkins is the real name, and Jack Nance sit down and supposedly the story goes on the back of a napkin, pen. It's only make believe.
Well, the story I heard is Jack was fooling around on the piano.
Okay.
And he took it to Twitty or Harold, and they got together and probably, like I said, put it together.
Man, what a hit song for those guys.
It's man, we were out west end with traveling, me and John and Ray, J.C. Cothran and Crawford. And everywhere we'd turn the radio, no matter where was that, Only Make Believe was playing. I'm talking about it was everywhere. A monster.
Still one of my favorite songs
I said,
of all time.
Harold's got him a hit there.
People see us everywhere. Oh, man. You know.
So anyway, that's kind of what happened. And then in 50, 60, I guess it was, yeah, Joe comes back home. Twitty doing something else. I forget what it was. But Joe wants to put together a band and go back to Canada in between jobs. So in between jobs, you don't get paid when you're paying, even if you're playing for a star.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if they come home and they say, well, yeah, I'm making $200 a week or two. Boy, that's good money. What they don't tell you is if they're not playing, they're not getting paid.
Sure.
You're not on salary.
You're not on a salary. You're paid by the gig or by the tour or whatever the case
may
be.
And anyway, he asked me if I wanted to go. Well, the Pacers, we wasn't doing nothing. We wasn't going nowhere. We was playing around here. And so I said, yeah, and left and went with Twitty. And then Twitty calls while we're up in Canada, about 3 weeks, and said, come back down into Ohio. Said, we're starting a tour. What the heck was it? Lonely Blue Boy had just hit big.
Mm-hmm.
And was big. So anyway, we came back, and Joe and I would go out and open up for Twitty. Jack had come back with us by then. We picked up Markham to go to Canada with us, Porkchop. Porkchop was with us too, but when Twitty played, Jack played drums. But when me and Joe would go out and open up the show, then Porkchop played drums and Jack played piano.
Mm-hmm.
Jack could play about anything. And I was playing bass.
Very talented, and I loved his mama. You know,
yeah.
She was my second grade teacher and principal at elementary school for a long time.
Mary Nance, boy, she was.
Uh-huh. Loved her. Mary Nance Stites, people around here may remember, just a wonderful lady, wonderful lady.
But that was the best. I'd have put that band up against anybody. Man, we didn't care who we went up against. We did a show one time. Bob Neal called us. He said, I got a couple of shows for you. He said, one in Little Rock at the Robinson Auditorium. One in Memphis at Ellis Auditorium, one on Saturday, one on Sunday. Said, you'll be there with Maddox Brothers and Rose. Whether you remember them or
mm-hmm.
not.
Yes, I do.
They wore those nudie costumes. Boy, there you talk about putting on a show. And there's about six or seven of them. Then you had Marty Robbins was on there and Ray Price. They were both big.
Love Ray Price.
So, I did too, man. I'm telling you what. Anyway, they put us in Little Rock. we opened for them. Well, of course, we'd always jump off the stage back in the Pacer. Me, Joe, Jack, and Johnny Ray would jump off stage.
You don't do that anymore, do you?
No, can't even get back on. Back then, we could jump off those stages and get back on them pretty easy.
Yes.
Me and Joe had long guitar chords. Yeah. Joe was playing bass by then. Well, we didn't even look at Robinson Auditorium, but when we jumped off, it was an orchestra pit. Down, and that's about 3 foot further.
Yeah, hello. You're waiting for that floor
to
come
outside, all these people jumping up and looking. Of course, and when we get to Memphis the next day, they made us come on last. They said didn't want to follow us.
Yeah.
That's the actual truth.
Well, it was a great station. I can tell you that my father used to allow me and with mom and dad to sneak in and get a look sometimes out the moon when the big guys were coming. Fats Domino would come into play, or, you know, the guys were on tour. And I got to see your guys' show one night, and that was, I got to say, it's a pretty high energy show, you know.
When
you were in your 20s, sir, it was indeed a high energy show. We got another break to take. Let me quickly remind you first. One of our great sponsors, folks at the Jackson Funeral Home here in Newport. They have been taking care of families for years and years and years, and they are pleased to be a part of this program where we talk about Jackson County history and some of the great people here in Newport, Arkansas, and we remember when. The Jackson family, our family, serving your family. They're great folks. They're great corporate citizens, and we appreciate their support. We'll be right back with Sonny Burgess.
Wasn't doing nothing, did you find it around? Dead cat and a boogie all over town. Well, down Front Street, baby, and all over town. Man, you ought to see the light when the sun goes down. Dead cat and a boogie. To the dance hall and a cuddling rug. Oh, we're running like wildfire and a hitting that jug. Dead panning and a boogie all over town.
Welcome back, everybody. We're visiting with the legendary Sonny Burgess. You don't ever get tired of anybody calling you the legendary, do you?
Because I thought you were supposed to be dead to be called
No, and I don't want you dead. I just want you to remain a legend, and you always will be. Sonny Burgess, Albert Sonny Burgess, from Newport, from Anderson, Arkansas, you know, and Newport in Jackson County, and one of our heroes. A member, as I said earlier, of the Hall of Fames, Newport High School, Hall of Honor, Hall of Fame. Great honor last year, you know, to be inducted into the Hall of Fame.
And I've been lucky enough to live long enough to get in.
Well,
that's, outlive everybody else. I'll get in
there. No, that's not true. No, you got to do a little something, you know, and it's just, it's wonderful to have you in there. It is that's a tremendous honor. I want to go back to the redheaded woman, and we want a boogie. Which redheaded woman sold, what'd you say, 300,000 copies?
Yeah. Well, We Want a Boogie was the other side, so it...
Yeah. Was it released with the A side, We Want a Boogie? Do you remember?
No. Back then, well...
Somebody told me
that
We Want
a Boogie, I think, was the A side.
Yeah, right. And
they
and,
did. That, you're right. They
and
did
somebody flipped
then.
It over and started playing Redheaded Woman, and look at here, you know?
Yeah,
and,
they...
And went nuts.
Well, the We Want a Boogie saying has been around, and we had a guy... I wrote a book a few years ago, Macmillan Publishing up in Minneapolis, a big book about rockabilly and rock and roll, and
yes.
Called it We Want a Boogie.
Okay. So people don't know this. You wrote those two songs.
Yeah.
Not only record them, but
wrote them
you
too.
Wrote them.
Thank goodness.
Now tell me the story about Redheaded Woman, because
I've
heard this. You know?
That's about Joanne.
Yeah.
My wife.
Uh-huh.
So that one,
Joanne Adams.
We Want a Boogie. I guess that just came to me about Front Street in Newport, Arkansas. You go down that Front Street, boy, it was just lit up like Christmas.
And Redheaded Woman, to me, the first time I ever heard that, it reminds me of one of the Bob Dylan songs with all everybody in the background. Sound like they're just having a ball. And redheaded woman, redheaded mama.
You know, again,
they are just having such a blast.
Oh, we did back then, man. It was fun. Like I said, the money had nothing to do with it.
You just
it
go in the
fun.
Studio, and they got the echo in the studio, you know, and your voice is echoing, you know, and it just, I love the sound, and you cannot listen to that record without starting to do this, tap that foot, you know. It just,
it's still one of our best songs, well, probably the best we do, because Redhead Woman is. It's just, it's got a good dance beat.
Oh, it's...
I'll give that to K.K. Kennedy. He's the one that did the takeoff on that and set the rhythm.
All right,
as he did on a lot of our stuff. He, Kern had a, well, still got a tremendous head for sound and plays by ear.
Yeah, isn't that amazing? Yeah.
You know, but Elvis played by ear. So did the Beatles.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
A lot of the, Bob Dylan, I'll bet you didn't read music.
Sam Phillips on the PBS special. And if you guys didn't say it, it was a few years back. And we got copies of it. We replayed it here on Cable 15 with permission from PBS. Great show about Sun Records. And did an extensive interview with you and Billy Lee Riley. Two local guys at the time. Billy Lee had moved to Newport, was living here, lived here several years. Married to Joyce Martin, a classmate of mine, in class of 68. Sam Phillips said, and I want to find out how you really truly feel about what he said. You see, I think you're a great star. I do. I think you've accomplished so much. I mean, you're in the European Hall of Fame. You just, you know, I do. I always looked upon you as a great guy, a friend, and a great rock and roller. But Sam Phillips said the biggest mistake he ever made was not taking you and getting you elevated to the status of worldwide, international, famous star at the time. How do you feel about that, about what he said?
Well, like I always try to tell Riley, hey, if it was meant to happen, I think life is, things happen in life that are meant to happen, not because, well, everything happened because of things you do, but if me and Riley had meant to have been big stars, we would have been. Something would have happened to made us big stars. But it didn't, but we turned out pretty good anyway. That's what I always say, so why?
Okay, all right. That's a good answer.
Yeah, my only mistake, like I said, was not taking Joe and trying to make a star out of him.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think he had, looking back, I can see, now I've got sense enough. But back then, like I said, it was fun time. It wasn't, you know, in other words, we didn't think about being big stars. That really didn't
We're having fun, making a few bucks.
Making a few bucks, having a lot of fun, and meeting all the gals you never got to talk to.
Right. And of course, you know, many of you may not know Big Joe Lewis we're talking about, tragically killed in an automobile accident or motorcycle accident, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. A tragic loss and a shock to the community. And, you know, I've had people ask me, you know, they've been through Walnut Grove Cemetery and the beautiful, you know, tombstone over there. I said, who was this guy? And I said, well, you just need to, you're in a position now where you can Google, well, you can Google the name or Google Sonny Burgess or Conway Twitty, and you'll find out about Big Joe. And Jack Nance died just a few years ago. And Jack had been later years married to another classmate of mine, Vicki Lowry, you know?
Yeah, that's right.
And I was disc jockeying out at Mom and Papa Keel's for 3 or 4 or 5 years. And every time Jack and Vicki were in town, you know, he'd come up and visit and we'd talk, share a new story or two. And Jack went on, had a good career in management. And one time managed Dionne Warwick and the Jackson Five. And,
Well, that's when he was working for Dick Clark.
Yes.
See, when Twitty broke up the rock and roll band, Jack went to work for Dick Clark a little later. Went to the West Coast and they had that TV show, Dick Clark. Dick Clark always tried to get in the country field. Tried and tried.
Okay.
Everything he did in it, boom, never done any good. I don't know if they have the feel for it or what, but anyway.
Yeah, his niche
he had
was
Monty
top 40.
B,
yeah.
Russell Draper, and Roy Clark. They had a TV show out on the West Coast. Dick Clark's putting this, I forget what it's called now. You can look it up, but anyway, Jack was the man that put the band together, produced it, and so forth and so forth. And then when that didn't go over too good, Dick Clark put him together doing the Jackson 5. He was the road manager for Jackson 5, Paul Revere and the Red, all those teeny boppers he had up there at Philadelphia that he made star. Jack took them out on the road. Then he got in with Dionne Warwick.
TSOP, The Sound of Philadelphia.
Yeah. And, yeah, Jack did well. And then along the last, before he died, he had moved back to Nashville. He'd try to get back in the writing business again. But it's hard. Nashville's a tough nut. You know, Larry Churcher, my cousin out here, lives out here. He's married to Anime, Red Garrison's daughter. Mm-hmm. He was a big songwriter in Nashville there for 15 years, made a living. Mm-hmm. And even had some records put out on him. But
Little Larry was a baseball coach here for American Legion.
Yeah, that's right. And Little Larry's a musician now.
Yeah.
Got a good band.
Known Big Larry, you know, Billy Garrison and I were running buddies in high school.
Yeah, I remember
I was always around, Red and Miss Faye and the whole family, all the girls and Billy. And just great bunch of folks.
Anyway, Larry, when them boys got a little bigger, he wanted to bring them back here to play baseball. And he did. But you can't live in Newport, Arkansas, I don't think, and I think he proved that, and doing it good in Nashville. You got to be over there.
Right, got to be there.
Knocking on them doors with everybody else.
Bill Keady, Coach Bill Keady, your friend, my friend.
Everybody's friend.
Everybody's friend wants me to ask you a couple of things. I'm going to start off along this line. You mentioned Cash and Roy. There's Roy Orbison, Jerry Lee Lewis. You guys and another fellow, what's his name? Elvis
Presley.
Elvis Presley. That was a guy. Bill is a huge Presley fan.
Elvis is one of my heroes.
Yeah,
Elvis and John Wayne.
He wanted to know. Tell us about meeting Elvis. Did you ever sit down and record with him? Did y'all ever visit, or was it just hit and miss? Or were all those guys there together at one time recording? Or how'd that work?
Well, you know, they had that $1 Million Quartet, which Carl Perkins. That was Carl Perkins actually doing a recording session. And Jerry Lee was there playing piano for him. Jerry Lee had just come tonight to Memphis.
Carl Perkins, the original version of Blue Suede Shoes.
Yeah.
And also, he did record, I Was There When Memphis Gave Birth to Rock and Roll. <you know? laughs>
Anyway, but far as our part now, when we cut the instrumentals when we was in Memphis, Jack Clements, Riley was there and played harmonica on Itchy and Thunderbird.
Okay.
And Charlie Rich played piano. Kern wasn't with us for that. So you'd use different musicians come in. We cut Sadie's Back in Town. We had Tommy Wagner, the Suddeth Brothers, and Raymond Thompson. You remember Daddy had the shoe shop? Mm-hmm. Raymond was a heck of a drummer. He's the one that did the Donald Duck sound on that. And then some old boy was there from Canada, a piano player, a Jerry Lee wannabe, and he played piano for us.
From Faraday, Louisiana. So tell me about Elvis.
Elvis was one of the best guys you ever seen. He was really good. First ran into him out here at Porky's Rooftop, or over here at Porky's Rooftop.
1954, maybe? 1954?
55.
Okay.
When he had it on the top of the, Porky had it on top of the restaurant.
Porky Sellers.
I gave you a picture there, yeah. Porky was a character. He had the Arkansas Playboys. He thought he was Bob Wills.
Yeah.
Anyway, I went over there to hear.
Nobody I knew disliked Herschel Sellers. I mean, he was a character.
Yeah. He had played that night up here at the Armory, Elvis had, then came out there at Porky's. I went to Porky's to see him, and it had about half a crowd, looked like, when he started. But all these old gals was there, and I guess they got out and started calling. And before he got through, that the place was full of women.
So you got to come here. This can see this guy.
Yeah, see this. It's entirely different than anything else in the world we was used to seeing. And then next time I see him, is Porky brought him out to the Silver Moon because it was bigger. Had Wanda Jackson, what the heck, Daydreaming out of Memphis. And then you had Elvis. And Wanda was about 18 or 19. Oh, she looked good. Boy, had her daddy. Mm-hmm. Everybody was after her. But anyway, and then we got together and got talked on in the footing the bill. We brought Elvis back to the moon. And your dad, I think your dad and mom was at all those shows.
You bet.
Because they liked to dance. Boy, they were good dancers.
They did.
And Then a little later on, Bob King went up there swiftly. This is all in 1955 now.
So things are happening.
Yeah, things
are They are really booming. Happening. Rock and roll's forming.
Yeah.
Rock and roll's about to be born.
Yeah. They, yeah, everybody had a band, and they were all good and different. And
well, I mean, what a change in the world, Sonny. Yeah. What a change, rock and roll. Let me change
well, yeah,
everything.
You go from the music back then was your pop, classical, rhythm
big
and
band,
blues.
Big band coming out of the 40s. Yeah.
Country, which was strictly guitars and fiddles. And then
and all of a sudden,
and
you know,
all of a sudden you're here,
Million Dollar
Elvis
Quartet
comes.
And you guys.
Yeah, Elvis comes along and everything changes. Then in 64, the Beatles came along and everything changed
again.
Then in the 70s, the rhythm and blues, I always liked rhythm and blues
yeah,
best
Yeah, Motown
of all.
Music, yeah.
Yeah.
But you
the
know,
Motown
still,
come along.
It's still rock and roll.
Yeah, yeah, still got
still
the beat.
Rock and roll. You know, grandkids, you know, kids and grandkids, two and three generations now, are listening to rock and roll, you know?
Yeah, they can dance to it.
It's changed, you know. For about 15 years, people listen to swing music, and then 15 years listen to big band music. And now for 50 years plus, we're listening to rock and roll.
Yeah.
Still listen to it today.
Yeah, and they'll dance to it, young kids will. That's the good part. But I always said, I wish I could find the person. There's going to be somebody come along that's going to change music again. It'll change.
Yeah, what's the next big thing? That's what they're saying.
Yeah.
Computers and technology, what's the next big thing?
Well, I hope not, because,
thing,
see, the computers are taking tweeters and all that. People are not talking to each other anymore.
They don't, and it's not, and in the studio, it's not music much anymore. It's all synthetic.
No, it's like country. Country all of a sudden has become soft rock.
Yeah.
Or hard rock for some of them.
Yeah, traditional country's gone.
Yeah.
It's absolutely gone.
What was Keaty's other question?
He just really wanted to talk about those guys. You know, he really wanted to know what you felt about Elvis.
Elvis was super good, boy. How many times
you met Elvis?
Well, we met him again later in 1959 when he was in the Army. We were in Memphis with Orbison. Orbison traveled a lot with us for 3 years. See, when they got paid for Ooby Dooby, Little Johnny, if you remember him, Little Johnny and the big bass player that did the Bug Dance, which the Pacers did.
Mm-hmm.
That was really popular for us too, the Bug Dance.
And see, Roy Orbison was a major star who probably didn't get as much credit until after his death.
Yeah.
I mean, but now they go back and play all Orbison. Most of the kids my age know Pretty Woman, and they won't go back any further than that. They won't go back to Ooby Dooby.
Yeah.
They won't go back to Pretty Paper.
He had a lot of good stuff. All Pretty Paper. That
Only the Lonely, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Anyway, they quit him. So Bob Neal said, well, how about him traveling with you guys? At that time, we were down to four pieces with that old green stretch limo we'd bought, Cadillac. But yeah, he traveled 1,000,000 miles with us, never bought a nickel worth of gas. He was tight with that book. Somebody else told me that about him. And we'd get a room, of course, there's four of us, and we could go two, me and Johnny Ray and Crawford and J.C., to a bed. Orbison would get him a $5 rollaway and roll in there with us. But
well, y'all look at true stories about Roy, the legendary great Roy Orbison here. You know,
but he was a great guy, though. He was really good. He had a great sense of humor. A lot of good jokes and good stories. He's just a super good guy. Just
our friend Billy Lee Riley recorded a song called Red Hot. That was quite a hit.
Yeah.
Also. And Billy Lee tells me, and of course Billy Lee and Sam Phillips, I don't think ever saw eye to eye. And I think Billy Lee got mad at Sam and trashed Sun Studios one evening.
Billy says, you know, that he came in there when Sally was doing them and said he seen the orders for Red Hot. But Jerry Lee had come out with a whole lot of shaking, I believe.
Yes.
And Sam, of course, Sam only had three people working for him. That's Jack Clemens himself and Sally Wilburn. You know, what can three guys do? He had his brother Judd, but Judd stayed drunk all the time.
Yeah, and Sam didn't know what he had. He didn't know what time
he had. He didn't have the people are the, you know, to really push more than one person at a time. Mm-hmm. That was it. And Riley says that Sam had all these orders for Red Hot, but he...
And pulled them back.
But he put sent them a whole lot of shaking.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he really.
And the next thing you know, Lewis is on the Ed Sullivan Show, and and all of a sudden, a whole lot of shaking goes to the top of the rock charts and everything else, and he becomes a major international star. And it just, I can see where Billy Lee was a little bitter about that. I mean,
was bitter.
As you say, that's life.
Yeah, that's life for him, because I've asked him, and I said, "What would you do if you're Sam Phillips and you had me and Jerry Lee Lewis?" I said, "Which one would you put your money on?"
Right.
The world's most copied piano player in the world. That's what folk don't know how many players. I've even seen classical piano players sit down and play a little Jerry Lee Lewis.
Mm-hmm. By the way, for those of you who may not know, and we have some younger viewers, that Sam Phillips was the owner and founder of Sun Records, the great Sun Records on Union Avenue in Memphis, Tennessee. So we mentioned Sam Phillips. There's probably a lot of people sitting there saying, "Y'all keep talking about Sam. Who is Sam Phillips?"
He became a multimillionaire. You know, he bought property. He quit fooling with it. He turned everything over to Jack Clemens until he got mad at Jack and fired him. Then it just boomed. You know, Sun Records don't last about 10 years.
Mm-hmm. And he sold Elvis's contract, I believe, to RCA.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And then Elvis.
Well, he needed the money. See,
sure. And the next thing you know, Elvis is... in Hollywood, and that's a different story.
But look at the stars he had come through there, man. I'm kind of like DJ Fontana, Elvis the drummer. Mm-hmm. People talk about that building house magic, and tons of people recorded there. It's still recording at Old Sun. But DJ says the magic left when guys like Charlie Rich, Elvis, Jerry Lee Lewis, Perkins, all of us, that bunch there in the 5 or 6 years, right. Riley and everybody else left. The magic left then.
I met a bunch of those guys, I'm pleased to say, down through the years. So we got to take another quick break. We got more to talk about. Are you doing okay?
I'm doing good, not worn out. I still haven't got to my little list.
Okay. I know you are over 50 years old, you know, and so you might wear down real fast.
Okay, no.
I've seen you play on stage recently. You haven't worn down any. You know, we'll be right back with Sonny Burgess.
It's a real pleasure to play with these guys. Man with the fire in his guitar, Mr. Dave Albert. And Brother Phil was a fantastic voice.
Mind you also that our program is brought to you in part by our friends down at the Jackson Funeral Homes on Malcolm Avenue here in Newport, and serving you from locations throughout Northeast Arkansas. And we appreciate the Jackson family, who are very interested in our community and our history and willing to partner with us on this program. The Jackson Funeral Home, our family serving your family since back in the 40s, something I don't quite remember. I didn't get here until 50, but our guest Sonny Burgess remembers the 40s pretty good. Hey, many of you have heard of Freddie Hart, who had a smash number one multi-million selling song called Easy Lovin'.
Will's a dandy.
Yes. Many of you don't know that Freddie Hart worked in Newport at KNBY. Tell us about Freddie Hart.
Well, see, when we got our little radio show with Dick Wheaton, me and Gerald Jackson,
Wheaton was the manager.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was the manager. He said, do you guys want a 30-minute show? Said, I've got this guy, Fred Wainard. So we got Fred, and we had A.L. Wilson. We had Gerald Jackson, me, John Ray Hubbard, and Forrest Miller playing fiddle, Mountain Sand. So they got us with Freddie, and we had 30 minutes every morning, I believe 5 to 5:30 or 5:30 to 6, I forget which it was. We're doing this live.
Live in the morning. Is
Fred,
that real?
Yeah, Fred was really good, old Freddie. Well, you do that show and then go to work. Fred was really good even back then. He had a ton of songs, and he'd do I Love You a Thousand Ways was hot back then.
Okay.
And he'd do it every day for a girl over Newport.
Okay.
And her name was Wilma Posey.
All right.
He wound up marrying her before I left, and when I went in the Army in 50. And when I come back, Fred was gone. And a couple of years later, I heard that all of a sudden he's Freddie Hart out in California, and he's wearing a sweater. Well, I heard it actually. Hearts all over it. But to make the story short, what happened is he went to work for Capitol Records. He was on the town hall party, which was a big show. We played it with Cash. When we was with Cash, we got to play it one time. But big country, had all Ernest, Tex Ritter and all those people was on. Freddie was a big star on there, but his record sales on, he had Keys in the Mailbox and different songs he recorded for Capitol. Sale began to fall, and they had already cut Easy Lovin', which everybody remembers now, but they put it in the can. In other words, they dropped Fred off of the label, so they let him go. Well, about a month or so later, somebody's fooling around in there, one of the wheels, and he hears this song, Easy Lovin'. He said, that's a hit. He said, how come we got this? So then they had to go and hire Fred back, sign him back to contract.
Until they can release it.
Yeah, so they can release it, and it sold millions.
Yeah, what a song. But see, Freddie Hart was a disc jockey at KNBY. And that, you know, people may have heard that story, but absolute true, and here's a witness to it. We have another list. You've got a list of things you wanted to mention and talk about, and so you just tell me what's on your list. And
okay, I'd want to tell them about, they need to get up and see the Rock and Roll Highway 67 Museum at Walnut Ridge, which says the Guitar Walk is really fantastic, and also down here at the Chamber of Commerce, which we've got our Newport's Rock and Roll Museum, and it's really got a lot of the good pictures and things that they'll want to see. And Henry Boyce is in charge of that.
Right.
And that's a good setup. Second Tuesday in April, the Pace will be over here at the Newport Country Club for that Blues Day Tuesday.
All right.
A freebie.
All right.
Bud, you can come over and dance a little bit.
You've seen me over there a couple of times before, have you not? Yes, you have.
Yes, I have. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you boys always, Kenny makes all of them, man. And then also March the 1st, the Rockabilly Boogie Fest at ASU is putting on, which last year was the first one. This year we've got Charlie Rich Jr. He played just like Charlie, sang just like him, and wears some of his coats.
You see, and I'm a fan of the early Charlie Rich. Everybody, of course, he hit it again as the Silver Fox, you know, with Behind Closed Doors, Most Beautiful Girl. But Mohair Sam, Lonely Weekends, that's my
Lonely
stuff.
Lonely Weekend was a dandy boy.
That's my stuff, yeah. And that's years before, you know.
So yeah.
He's a hit in the 50s, and then 20-year hiatus, and in the 70s, you know, has hit records again.
I think Charlie liked to, his wife finally got him straightened out. He liked to drink a lot.
He did drink a lot, yeah.
He drank too much, in fact. Oxford Magazine just had the last issue, just had a nice article on him.
Born down in Colt, Arkansas, just outside of Forest City.
Mm-hmm. There was a baseball player from down there. What was his name? Signed with the Cardinals.
A baseball player from Lindsay?
B. Lindsay, yeah.
Yeah, Donnie Kessinger, played with the Cubs.
Oh, yeah, played ball against Donnie Forest City.
Right. All right, let's talk. Is that all on your list?
That's all I had here.
Okay, all right. You wanted to be a baseball player.
Oh, I wanted to be a baseball player bad. I just couldn't hit that curveball.
Okay, all right. Did you on radio, did they have broadcast the games back then, or did you have did you listen to the Cardinals?
Yeah, that's about all you can get, Harry Carey and Pee Wee Reese.
Okay.
I got to see them one time and went to see the Cardinals games.
Right, okay.
Got to see them.
You and I are a few of the folks still living that may have been to Old Sportsman's Park.
That's where I was at, yeah. Yeah.
With the big old Lon Jeans clock out in center field. And I remember if somebody hit a home run and that eagle would fly out there, you know. It just
Catcher for the Giants. Cardinals playing the Giants, and the catcher, Bailey, I believe was his name.
Hal Bailey.
He hit two home runs Bailey. That day out over right field. Then I saw the Boston Braves.
Not the Milwaukee Braves, but the Boston Braves.
The Boston Braves. I guess it's Boston. Let me see.
Yeah. Warren Spahn. I saw him over in the Milwaukee Braves.
Spahn. Let's see. Who else? Eddie Matthews. Boy, you talk about a good swing. He had a good swing. The home run man. What's his name?
Hank Aaron?
Huh? Hank Aaron was playing. Mm-hmm. Didn't hit nothing, the game I saw. Pop-ups, third base. Borger was playing third. Farm, Musial. Musial had a couple of hits. In fact, I think he hit a home run. And old Bob Uecker, remember him? I never will forget that. We got to see two or three games in a row. The main catcher, Joe Torre, got spiked. And they brought in Bob Uecker. That was with him. And he, for the Braves. And old Kurt Flood could steal them bases back in. I never will forget that. Whoever's pitching, Kurt heads out for second base. He's going to steal second. He could run, too. And old Uecker, ball hit the dirt. He picked that thing up. And I'm telling you, if that pitcher hadn't moved, it'd have hit him because it went like a bullet. He throwed him out.
He couldn't hit, but
he could flat catch, boy.
And Uecker later became a Cardinal announcer. Yeah. He was on their radio broadcast in 64 when they won the World Series. After a long wait, I think they won in 46 and then again in 64. Are you old enough to remember the Gas House Gang in the early 30s? Dizzy
No,
Dan,
I don't
Pepper
remember
Martin?
Much about them. I've read a lot about them, but I thought Cardinals was about as good as you got, even today. But they had some of the best. Who was the center fielder they had? It didn't miss nothing. You hit it out there that. He's got a restaurant now, I think, in St. Louis. He was a few years ago.
Well, see, anything about center field? Who? Jim Edmonds?
Yeah, Jim Edmonds.
Yeah, okay. David came up with that one, Edmonds.
I got to see Dick Grote. Dick Grote was playing shortstop.
He was on the 64 World Series team.
Yeah, he was good.
They had in 64, the Cardinals had their starting infield. Was Bill White at first, Javier at second. Grote at short, Borger at third, was a starting infield for the National League in the All-Star game.
I got to see them play.
That was a great ball club. Johnny Keene was the manager, and he won the World Series, and they were going to fire him in the middle of the year because the team was struggling, so he just quit, went to the Yankees, became the manager of the Yankees, you know. Cardinals hired a fellow named Red Shanice, and he won two pennants and a world championship
in
67.
I got to see Red play. I got to see George Kell play down here at Little Rock. They were playing the Cardinals. He was with the White Sox. Remember when he was with the White Sox?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. He was playing. Boy, he made a couple of plays. I'm telling you, they hit a couple of shots down third base, and he dove over, caught that thing. come up on his knee and flip him out. Old
Ripulski, yeah,
was playing first base, I believe it was. Wally Moon was playing in that game. He just
Arkansas
boy. Just brought him up, and he was playing right field for the Cardinals. Then he went from there to the Dodgers, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where he got famous.
Bill Verdon started out in center field, and they traded him to Pittsburgh and to make way for Flood.
He was a good one, too, Verdon.
And Lou Brock, of course, a great player, a Hall of Famer.
Yep, I got to see. I got to see about all them guys.
McCarver,
I don't know anymore because Tim McCarver.
Yeah. I'm like you. My health has got me in a position where I don't get to go to many games. But boy, I sure watch them on television.
Well, I do that. Yeah, I'll tell you who I used to really like, simply because of Harry Carey, was the Cubbies. Television.
I'm a Cub fan and I'm a Bud man.
Yeah. But since he's left them and they got rid of Steve Stone, I like Steve Stone too. I don't ever watch him anymore.
Yeah. Harry Carey was my broadcast idol. I got into sports casting.
Yeah, that's right. You was big in sports casting.
I got
you
into,
and David Bowles.
Yeah,
did a
I got
lot of
into
that.
Sports broadcasting by listening to Harry Carey. And I just. And I remember the first time I ever saw a picture of him. You know, you don't see these guys. This is late 50s, early 60s. You hear them on the radio, and you imagine what they look like. And then when you see them, it's totally opposite. I thought he was some bald-headed guy, skinny guy with glasses. And he's this rotund man, you know. But to listen to Harry Carey, and I'll never forget him described, might be, it could be, you know, oh, it's caught. And I got there and got a game and a transistor radio, and it'd be a pop-up in the short left field, and Harry Carey would say, it's deep, it might be, it could, no, the left fielder makes the catch. Well, even close, you know. He's embellishing that broadcast.
Yeah, I got to see Dizzy Dean.
Okay, yeah.
When he was doing broadcast. You know, they used to have those little tricks they'd do, that had a pencil or something that hit, sound like crack of the bat.
Oh, sure. Recreation of a game. Yeah, instead of the actual play-by-play. Yeah.
Let your imagination work. See, nowadays, but it's more thrilling, I guess, with imagination.
Yeah, well, they tell the announcers just to shut up and
some of them are not very good nowadays. Boy. Well,
that's just because of the proliferation of what we've talked about, television, of all of the access to television, the hundreds of channels available to you, and so you got to hire people. You got to hire people to do these games, so whether it's especially college football and basketball, I mean, people you never heard of, you know, broadcasting ball game. And they've all been to broadcasting school, and they get the job done. But
they don't
it's
have
not like the old days,
yeah,
when there were 8 or 10 great guys that did everything. You know, Jack Buck used to do not only the Cardinals, he'd do the Dallas Cowboys, and he'd do a bunch of All-Star games and Pro Bowls and things like that. Jack Buck, you know, did hockey for a while even in St. Louis. So, you know,
I don't particularly like his son. His son gets a lot of good job, but
he's the lead announcer for Fox now.
Yeah, he's not a favorite of mine. McCarver's pretty good,
and he's going to do 30 games this year with the Cardinals. Did you see that, McCarver? Who announced he resigned from Fox. He said he didn't retire. He has signed on to do 30. Television games this year. Shannon's not going to do as many games like he did last year. He's going to sit at home some. But McCarver's going to do 30 games for the Cardinals.
Oh, Roboski's pretty good.
Yeah, he's a little controversial, but that's part of it. You know.
Well, I kind of like him, get a little fire, a little different. I'm tired of those that. And of course, football and basketball now. TV has got so it wears them out.
Yeah.
In other words, why did Manning throw that pass, or why?
They overanalyze.
Oh, I don't know. He shouldn't have done that, and shouldn't. They overanalyze everything.
I hate for somebody to come on there, it's like a political analyst, and tell me what some guy just said.
Yeah,
and
what you watched with your own eyes.
I heard what he said, and I saw what they did. You know, okay. Well, now what the president really meant here was, no. I heard what the man said. You know, you don't have to tell me over and over and over again. Anyway, you served as assistant baseball coach, we said, American Legion, for your love of the game, love of the kids.
Oh, those were good days, man.
You had kids playing ball. You know, John and Peyton both played ball.
Yep.
You know?
John and Peyton both.
Yeah. And you tragically lost a son, we all know about. But those guys were pretty good baseball players, you know? Just, they got it from the old man, huh? Yeah.
No, they were a lot better than I was.
They were. They were good players. They were really good players. So it has been a wonderful career, and it's and it's still going. You got Jeannie and the guys. And
that's right. That's we got Jeannie and the guys still going. Started that about 17 years ago up here at Swift and the Blended Community Center. All right. And then we also in between there, me and Larry, along with Jeannie and Doug, formed a Stranger's Home, which Larry named after a cemetery in, out of Swifton.
And my old radio
That's
buddy,
our gospel group.
Radio buddy Dale Turner played a lot with you
Dale
guys.
Yeah, Dale Turner played a lot with us. And also Dale wrote some good gospel songs. And then I'm on the third, let's see. Well, the best band I ever had was the Original Pacers, the best show band, More Life, it creative. Then I'd say the second best would probably be the this band, the Kings Four. We did the 60s and 70s music.
But Sonny, you're still recording.
Yeah,
you've got a new CD out.
Yeah, we Jack White, and we got a new one out that just came out last year. In Sweden, while we're over there, we cut an album. So, and now I believe we've got 21 CDs for sale.
Are you still going to Europe?
Yep, going to, I was going to tell you that. We're going to Las Vegas in April and going to Spain in September, I believe it is. I love Spain.
Well, they love you.
It's well, they do that, but it's warm over there, boys.
And
you'd
I know,
like it over there.
And
boy.
I know you've always done well at Vegas, too. You know?
Yeah, Vegas is good. Well, say get all those Europeans come in. Thank goodness for us old guys like Riley and all that live long enough to enjoy that
second bite at the apple. Yeah.
Revival of rockabilly music or rock and roll music in Europe, Japan, South America. I've had ran into bands out of South America record some songs that I wrote.
Well, that's a couple of dollars.
Yeah. Well, no, they don't get played that much. Okay. Maybe 15 cents.
Well, that's all right. Every little bit adds up. It just it has been an extreme honor. You know, Sonny and I hope y'all can tell we both know a lot. He's been around a little longer than I have. We know a lot about the music business. I'm not a musician. The only thing I can play is radio. But it has been a blast to sit and visit with you. And as I said, you've been my friend for a long, long time, starting down at Buddy Black's Tire Store in 1956 down on 3rd
Dunlop
Street.
Dunlop Tire, boy. I'm telling
Dunlop
you
Tires and Arthur Fulmer seat covers.
That Buddy Black was a super salesman. I'm telling you what, that guy.
And it seems like every kid in town worked for him at one time or another.
He could sell Eskimo's refrigerators.
And you know, we mentioned Conway Twitty earlier, and Conway Twitty would stop on occasion.
Yeah,
you know,
and buy tires.
Buy tires. Conway used to take me bowling. Conway, you know, when they were in town sometimes.
Do you remember when Harold had that Mercury? I bought a 57 Mercury and he bought one. His was so bad that he painted lemons all over it, and Mercury tried to sue him. Of course, he didn't have no money.
Oh, gosh. Well, I hope y'all have learned something about the music business and the history of rock and roll, and be pleased and proud that you live in a community in Jackson County where one of the pioneers of rock and roll is one of our own. And the great thing about Sonny Burgess is that through all the fun times and through all the recording and all the acceptance as a major star now, especially in Europe and all across in the field of music, people who know about music know about Sonny Burgess. But the most important thing is he's always remained one of us. He's always remained a Newportian, a Jackson Countyan, and has always been proud to be a part of this. And we are proud to know him and to love him. And Albert Burgess, sir,
Bud,
thank
I appreciate
you so
those good
much
words.
For everything you have done for us and everything you are doing and will continue to do.
Well, don't forget, Northeast Arkansas has got more good musicians, more bands, but they have got a ton of good musicians. And you know I do a radio show for KASU.
KASU on Sundays.
We Want a Boogie, 5 to 7, 91.9 FM on the radio dial.
Well, you can tell them that you're going to be on local TV in Newport here now and all the stuff we talked about.
When is this? So
This will be airing starting almost immediately and also almost all through February. Yeah.
Holy
Sunday
cow.
And Tuesday nights.
They'll be sick and tired of me by then.
Sunday and Tuesday nights, and we'll show it, so we want to make sure that everybody gets to see it, because this is a great show.
You and Dave is doing a great thing, I'm doing with this TV.
Thank you, sir.
I'd have been smart enough and thought about doing that. I had that idea once.
Well, I'm glad you did. And if I'd ever learned how to pick a guitar, yeah. I might have had a hit record like Red-Headed Woman.
After you've done it, I got to think. I said, no, that's a real good idea.
Well,
but I wasn't smart enough, see, to. Well, like a lot of things I've done, I wasn't too smart.
Stay right there and let me say goodbye to the folks out there. That's him right there. And we see him out at the grocery store. He goes to the grocery store like the rest of us. See Sonny out and about, say hello, tell him you saw the show, and you appreciate everything he's done for our community. I'm Bud Black for Remember When, each Sunday and Tuesday evening, D at 7 o'clock, each Sunday and Tuesday evening here on Cable 15 TV. Thanks for watching, everybody. We've loved this one. This is great.
But right now, I'd like to call a guy out that wrote a song that I recorded along with Gary Talent back in, for Rounder Records. He wrote this song called Tiger Rose. And his name is Bruce Springsteen. Hey! Tiger Rose, let me read some prose to you. Just as long as it shows my love, any verse will do. Honey, I could make you happy if you'd only let me. Heaven knows I'm white Tiger Rose.
I went to work this morning
on the local commuter train.
Thank you.